going to have a conversation with Jacqueline Musitwa. She's a leading expert on international trade law. She founded a boutique law firm called Hoja Law Group, which operates in New York and Kigali, Rwanda. She's also served as an advisor to the Director General of the WTO, the World Trade Organization, as well as an advisor to the Rwandan Minister of Trade, Investment and Infrastructure. Today we're going to have a conversation with her on international trade law and how that favors African countries and what we can do to improve those. Thank you once again and welcome to the conversation.
So thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
So I love reading about your background and reading your bio, and you do a lot of work on international trade. It's not a new focus, it's been a focus for a long time, on intra-Africa trade. We all know that it's low, and there is room for improvement, but then there is an argument that should we be focusing so intently on intra-Africa trade? So let's give an example. You're a Nigerian. You're big, huge population, and you're looking for a market that can, you know, a big market as well. And so do you go trade with your neighbor Ghana, which has, well, not your immediate neighbor, but your, you know, same West Africa, your neighbor Ghana, which has pretty much the same goods as you have in the sense of terms of complementarities? Or should you go trade with China, which has a huge market, and where you can probably get more, you know, bang for your buck? So the question is, should we really be focusing on intra-Africa trade, or should we be looking at bilateral trade agreements with bigger and more strategic countries?
I think that we need to look at both. I think that the reality of global trade at the moment is everything changes. Mm-hmm. And if there's anything we realized with the global economic crisis is that markets that are there today may not be there tomorrow. So we do need to make sure that we have different options. Now, having said that, I also think it forces us to look at the goods that we are exporting. And maybe this is time, once again, to examine what are we actually exporting and how can we provide the greatest value. I think the biggest challenge we have is that we are not exporting value-added goods. So, a country like Ghana exporting cocoa to a country like Ivory Coast, not really helpful, right?
Exactly.
But what regional integration really does is it allows countries to examine what are we as a region doing collectively. Mm-hmm. We know that our countries as individual units are very small trading units. So regional integration really forces the question of how can we work cooperatively within our units to really ensure that we collectively can be stronger trading blocks either within Africa or outside Africa. And so when I look at, for instance, the example of the East African community, I think that we have made very large strides compared to other regional blocks within the region. Why? It first was political will to say that we are going to make it happen. The original EAC obviously was disbanded, but when the new EAC came up, it was, what lessons do we need to learn from other parts of the world that have integrated? One, we as a region, what do we have collectively? And how can we maximize what we have collectively for the collective good? I think a problem is we tend to look at ourselves as individual countries, not really look at, you know, the region. So now you have a country like Kenya, after doing the analysis, said we have great markets close by. So now most of Kenya's goods are actually exported right to the north to Uganda. Mm-hmm. Similarly, Uganda is a heavy exporter of goods to South Sudan, Rwanda, and Burundi. And so the East African model, I think, is able to show us that there are different goods that we can complement each other with in different regions. Mm-hmm. It does take political will. It does take a strong private sector that realizes that there are markets close by. It does take fairly good infrastructure to actually connect these countries, because if you don't have roads, if you don't have rail,
it might be more expensive.
It is more expensive. Exactly. And that's actually one of the historical reasons of why inter-African trade has been so low.
Yeah.
It is terribly expensive to export things within the continent than it is
to
outside.
To Japan,
and even traveling. Mm-hmm. I travel a lot within the continent, And it is more expensive for me to fly from Nairobi to Lusaka than mm-hmm. it is from Nairobi to London. And so even as far as transport within the region, that cost ends up being factored in. Now, another thing historically is the US and the EU have had agreements of sorts that have made it easier for different African goods and primarily, unfortunately, raw materials to exactly. be exported into those markets. So the initial instinct has been, well, we have access to those markets for fairly cheap, and it's cheaper to transport. Why not? Now, I think what has happened within the past 20 years is there's been a change of play. Mm-hmm. It's not only the West, quote unquote, that is trading with Africa. Now, everyone talks about China, but I think that we shouldn't forget about Indonesia, Malaysia, India, Brazil, that are also huge trade partners with mm-hmm. Africa, that are causing stirs in their own right, because they are looking at different markets that yeah. weren't typically looked at yeah. in the past. I also think that bigger African economies are also starting to look more at other African economies. If you look at SADC, South Africa mm-hmm. is a very strong country that does trade a lot within the region. Mm-hmm. Kenya, equally, as I mentioned before. And so I do think that we need to look at all options mm-hmm. rather than singularly looking at one or another. And within that, we do need to make sure that we actually provide goods with additional value than simply raw materials, or we will continue to get the short end of the stick.